There have been 11 primary civilizations in the history of man. In 10 of them, a common pattern can be traced, very similar to that which we have described in comparing Greco-Roman and modern Western civilizations. But before we examine these other parallels, we need to understand clearly just what a civilization is. Cities define a civilization and distinguish it from barbarism, while the medium of communication among them marks its boundaries. Throughout the length and breadth of a common civilization, no matter how many cities and nations are included in it, one or two common languages are widely used and understood, with one or two common scripts used to write them. There is a common cultural heritage, most often shown by common religious beliefs and institutions, and by poetry and heroic tales known civilization-wide. By contrast, foreign civilizations have no language or script or literature or religion in common with their neighbor. That is how we can tell one civilization from another. But within the history of a civilization, we also have to make certain vital distinctions. The pattern we have been discussing, which is so clear in Greco-Roman history, has a sequel, which should never be confused with the pattern itself. That sequel can be called a successor state. A successor state is almost always formed in one relatively small corner of the territory occupied by the parent civilization at the height of its power and influence. The successor state is established in the last stages of the parent civilization's decay and may outlast it for many centuries. But during all that time, the successor state neither grows nor declines. It is static and sterile. Eventually, it is swallowed up by a new civilization. The successor state of the Roman Empire, one of the best examples of its kind, was the much smaller Byzantine Empire with its capital at Constantinople. With this background, we can move on to the other civilizations. Out of the total of 11, we have already discussed two, both in the West, that of Greece and Rome, and that of modern Europe and America. There was also a third civilization in the West, which came before the classical civilization of Greece and Rome, just as that came before our own. This earliest Western civilization developed in and around the Aegean Sea in Greece. The island of Crete was its original culture center, and the city of Mykenae on the Greek mainland was the center of the universal state finally established. Therefore, it may be called the Cretan-Mykenaean civilization. The story of the discovery of the Cretan-Mykenaean civilization is one of the most dramatic in all the annals of the advance of human knowledge. Its very existence was not suspected before the 20th century. All of the most vital facts about it have come to light only in the last 13 years, as a result of one of the most amazing intellectual feats ever performed, the decipherment of the script known as Linear B, in which the Mykenaean language was written. This script is the only one in the history of archaeology ever deciphered without the aid of a bilingual inscription. That is, an inscription of the same words in a known language alongside the unknown language. The decipherment, achieved in 1953 by a young Englishman named Michael Ventris, made it possible for the first time to read the records on clay tablets recovered from the ruins of Mykenaean palaces destroyed not long after the Trojan War. Most historians had expected that when these tablets were read, they would describe some primitive feudal society, or perhaps contain some early passages from the epic poetry which was later assembled in Homer's Iliad. Instead, to their great astonishment, the tablets proved to be the census and tax records of an almighty bureaucratic state, the Roman Empire of its day, in 1200 BC. With this striking insight, it is now possible to review all we know or can deduce about the history of Cretan-Mykenaean civilization, which ran from 2500 to 1100 BC, 1400 years, and find in it a remarkable parallel to the later history of Greece and Rome and to our own history as well. Once again, we find a dark age, the rise of cities, a cultural explosion and liberation of individual creative genius, a period of contending nation-states, an emerging leader which first promotes peace and free trade, but then establishes a total state, and the final decline and collapse of that empire and the civilization it enslaved and destroyed. Just as there were three civilizations in the West, so there were also three in the Middle East, similar in duration and in the pattern of rise and fall. The first was that of Sumer and Akkad in very ancient Mesopotamia from 3300 to 1600 BC, a span of 1700 years. The second covered a broader area from Palestine to Persia, known in part as the Fertile Crescent. It was this civilization which included all the nations and peoples, except the Egyptians, mentioned in the Old Testament of our Bible. It lasted from 1600 to 300 BC, a span of 1300 years. The third Middle Eastern civilization was that of Persia and Islam, running from 250 BC to 1258 AD, a span of 1500 years. Each one of these three Middle Eastern civilizations showed a pattern of rise and fall similar to that of Greece and Rome. Each had a period of relative freedom and divided sovereignty during which it was rising, and the establishment of a universal state which caused it to fall. The first of the three was marked off from the second by an unmistakable Dark Age. The second was marked off from the third by foreign conquest, by the Greeks under Alexander the Great, which had the same effects as a Dark Age upon the native peoples of the Middle East. The third was followed by a successor state, the Ottoman Empire of Turkey, which ruled what remained of a stagnant Islamic world until this century, when it would appear that the Middle East has been absorbed by Western civilization. Moving farther east to India, we find two distinct civilizations following each other in the years before Christ. The first arose in the Indus River Valley and is known as the Harappa civilization, from the name of the site where its most important ruins have been found. It appears to have run from 2600 to 1300 BC, a period of 1300 years, and to have followed the broad outlines of the pattern we have traced for Greece and Rome. Then came the more familiar Hindu civilization of India, which repeated the same pattern from 1300 BC to 300 AD, a period of 1600 years. After that, Indian culture was frozen into a static, unchanging condition by the caste system, leaving India prey to a succession of foreign conquerors. Three civilizations in the West, three in the Middle East, and two in India, makes eight. The remaining three appeared in China, in Egypt, and in Central America before Columbus. Chinese civilization followed the primary pattern from 1300 BC to 250 AD, but then shifted into another, which I call the short cycle, to distinguish it from the long cycle, which we have been discussing. As you may have noted, the long cycle averages about 1500 years, while the short cycle runs from 400 to 500. The short cycle is a regular alternation of total states and the economic and political collapses which result from them. There is no intervening period of growing freedom for individual production and trade, and divided sovereignty in the civilization area. Instead, there is only the universal state and its decay, constantly repeated. No lasting progress is attained. The burden of the state can only be supported by the unusually high fertility of the soil, in a basically agrarian economy, which has characterized China throughout history. Since completing its long cycle, China has gone through three of these unproductive short cycles, and with the establishment of communist power in Peking, appears to have begun its fourth. The tenth civilization is Egypt, and this is the only one which never followed the long cycle pattern. Instead, from the beginning of Egyptian history, we find a total state under a ruler literally worshipped as a god, and a repeating short cycle very similar to that of China. Once again, high soil fertility in a basically agrarian economy, the Nile Valley, made this possible. This short cycle of alternating despotism and collapse repeated itself four times in ancient Egypt until, in 525 BC, Egypt was absorbed by Middle Eastern civilization. The 11th and last of the primary civilizations was that of the Mayas of Guatemala, Yucatan, and southern Mexico before the coming of Europeans. The Mayan civilization, running from about 200 BC to 1450 AD, follows the long cycle like that of Greece and Rome with remarkable regularity. This is especially impressive because Mayan civilization was completely isolated from all its counterparts in the Old World. Yet still it showed the same pattern of rise and fall. Most convincing evidence of the tendency of man in society to follow that pattern regardless of external circumstances. Since 10 of these 11 civilizations all but Egypt, show a similar pattern of rise and fall, it is possible to draw up a list or table of common events which occurred in the same sequence and at roughly similar intervals of time in many or all of these civilizations. My research has provided data for the selection of no less than 25 points, most of them specific events, the rest marking clear-cut stages of development, which can be identified in four or more civilizations. All of the most important can be identified in at least 8 of the 10 civilizations, showing the long cycle pattern. The first point is the low spot, or depth of the Dark Age, separating one civilization from another. The second is the appearance or revival of writing and literature. The third is the rise of cities as centers of an active trading market. The fourth is a major geographical expansion resulting from this trade. Point five is the first appearance in the civilization of individualized poetry and literature, usually in the form of lyrics. The sixth point is the cultural explosion, the sudden flowering of individual creative genius, such as appeared in Periclean Athens and Renaissance Italy. Point seven is the emergence of powerful military states, which bring an end to the golden age of the small city-state. Point eight is the beginning of large-scale colonization in distant lands, undertaken by the emerging nations successful in war. Point nine is the permanent establishment of these nations and the lasting division among them of most of the territory in the civilization's heartland. Point 10 is the outbreak of the first great climax of warfare among these nations, and point 11 is the winning of a decisive victory in this war by one nation, which then becomes the leader in the whole civilization area. This was the point marked in Greco-Roman history by Rome's defeat of Carthage, and in the history of modern Europe by Britain's defeat of Napoleon at Waterloo. Point 12 is the upset of the internal political balance and an assault on wealth held in private hands through the medium of an expanding government power. Point 13 is the outbreak of another period of major international warfare, while point 14 is its conclusion, the victory by the power which is soon to set up the universal state. Point 15 is a temporary settlement ending a clash with a power semi-foreign or wholly foreign to the civilization, which was drawn into conflict with it as a result of the preceding war, which ends at point 14. This 15th point in our own civilization was the truce that ended the Korean War, whose causes went back to the fact that Soviet Russia was drawn into the Second World War. Point 16 is the assassination of the leader of the most powerful nation at a critical point in its own political evolution toward a total state. This event occurred in the second and third Middle Eastern civilizations, as well as in our own, with the assassination of President Kennedy, and in Rome, with the assassination of Julius Caesar. And there is some reason to believe that a major political assassination might have taken place at the same critical point in the history of Crete and Mycenae around 1425 BC. Point 17, in many ways the most important, is the establishment of a total or universal state in the prime power center of the civilization. The remaining points all have to do with the decline and periodic partial revivals of that empire. The 18th point is the beginning of a period of troubles resulting from disputes over the imperial succession. The 19th is the end of that period of troubles and the beginning of a period of relatively good administration by enlightened despots, who nevertheless are completely unable to halt the steady growth of government and its equally steady encroachment on the total taxable resources of the people of the empire. Point 20 is the economic collapse that comes when government has grown so gigantic and the producer has been so overburdened that no possible enforcement measures can any longer collect enough revenue to support the government. The desperate attempts to find that revenue destroy most of the available capital in the whole civilization. Point 21 is a second recovery of the empire, shrunken and much poorer, but with frontiers temporarily stabilized. Point 22 is the beginning of the final decline of the universal state. Point 23 is the beginning of the major barbarian invasions. Point 24 is the fall of the empire. The 25th and last point is the establishment of the successor state we discussed earlier. So far, our own civilization has passed through every one of the first 16 points in the list just given. The next point, 17, is the establishment of the total state in the prime power center of this civilization, which is the United States of America. In predicting when this will happen, we may compare the rate at which our civilization has proceeded along the course we have outlined with the rate in Greece and Rome. Up to the 19th century, our civilization moved considerably more slowly than any other, and more slowly than that of Greece and Rome. But in the 19th century, our civilization began to speed up until its rate approached and then exceeded the average. It seems a reasonable assumption that this was due to our technological advances, especially in transportation and communications, which made it possible for historic changes to affect a much larger area more quickly. In this 20th century, our civilization has continued to speed up until it is now moving at approximately twice the rate of Greece and Rome. Starting from point 16, the assassination of Julius Caesar, we find that Rome required 17 years, from 44 to 27 BC, to reach the point of the establishment of the total state. Starting from point 14, the end of a world war, Rome required 54 years, from 81 to 27 BC, to reach the total state. Since we are moving at double the rate, we should cover the same ground in half the number of years. In that case, we would reach the total state in 9 years at the most from the assassination of President Kennedy, or 27 years from the end of the Second World War. 9 years from 1963 is 1972. 27 years from 1945 is 1972. Thus, two vitally important historical pointers fall directly upon the year of what we could already expect without reference to any historic pattern to be perhaps the most critical presidential election in American history. Will the victor in that election be R. Octavian, R. Augustus Caesar, to establish the American Empire? The lesson of the historic pattern must tell us that this is probable and that his name will be Kennedy. Suppose this does happen. What then can be foreseen on the basis of what we have learned from history? There would then be in the world three great power centers, all essentially totalitarian: Washington, Moscow, and Peking. Washington would be the imperial capital of Western civilization, with unlimited power over the lives and earnings of American citizens. Russia, another total state, would occupy a place both geographically and culturally between East and West. It is most significant to find that in both of the Western civilizations preceding ours, there was a powerful military state on the eastern borderlands which was never absorbed by the Western universal state, but remained culturally and economically dependent on that universal state and collapsed at the same time. This parallel to the Soviet-Russian Empire in the Greco-Roman world was the Empire of Parthia, centered in northern Persia. In the case of Cretan Mycenaean civilization, it was the Hittite Empire in Asia Minor of 1400 to 1200 BC. A Western total state centered in Washington, in deference to modern sensibilities, would probably rule the West covertly rather than openly, without the military garrisons and resident governors that were found in the Roman Empire. But the effects, economic, political, historical, would be the same. The only remaining question would be, in what way, if any, would the great technological achievements of our civilization affect the process of decline begun by the establishment of the universal state? There is cause to believe that our great dependence on technology might actually hasten the decline once it is well underway. For as the burden of government and taxation grows greater, as the individual is more and more suppressed and made to feel that he does not count, there will be an increasing likelihood of human failures and breakdowns, both of mind and of will, at critical points in the interdependent network of our technology. The effect of such failures and breakdowns could be devastating. In this connection, the great Northeastern power failure of November 1965 stands as a grim warning. The picture just painted may at first glance seem so dark as not to admit a single ray of light. But remember the point we made at the outset, that there is no such thing as historical fatalism or determinism. The reasoning mind of man can alter or overcome any pattern which results from unreason, given time and full understanding. If the full scope and nature of this historic pattern had been known 50 years ago, it might have been relatively easy to change it before we came too close to the universal state. Now that we stand perhaps no more than 6 years from the total state, the task of making so great a change in so short a time is much more difficult. But it could be done if enough people realize the necessity. A total state is not effectively in being until it becomes self-perpetuating, until it is only possible to influence government by first becoming a part of its bureaucratic structure. To that point, we have not yet quite reached. That is why we stand at the last crossroads, and if enough decided to do so, the United States of America as a nation could still take the road away from tyranny toward liberty. That road would require us to reevaluate our whole view of government, to recognize that the only proper and rightful functions of government are to protect the life, liberty, and property of individuals through military defense and police, and to settle disputes among individuals by impartial courts practicing objective law. That road would require us first to halt the growth, then to begin the rollback of all laws and activities of government which regulate production, restrict trade, and redistribute wealth through taxation. Remember, history never stands still, and the giant government in our country today certainly will not stand still. It must either grow or shrink. Its continued growth will bring about a total state in a few more years. Its rollback, if begun now or in the next few years, would preserve our freedom, and with it, Western civilization. That should be our short-range strategy. But we should also have a long-range strategy, which would be unaffected even by the establishment of a total state here in America. That long-range strategy is one of understanding, of knowing the causes of what is happening to us, of proving out the historic pattern by watching to see if it does continue to repeat itself. If that understanding is attained, if that proof is given, and if this knowledge can be passed on to future generations, eventually the time will come when thinking, reasoning men will be able to act so as to break the historic cycle and establish freedom that will endure. Just when and how this might be done, if freedom is lost in America, we cannot now be sure. But if we believe in freedom, we should believe in it not only for our time and our fellow men, but for all times and for all men. We should remember that even if freedom perishes today, somewhere, sometime, it can be restored. And then, through understanding of history and the errors which have destroyed freedom in the past, preserved for an infinite and glorious future. Civilizations rise with individual freedom, and they fall with total government power. That is the truth we must remember, live by, and act upon if true and lasting progress is ever to come to the human race.